What is macrophage activation syndrome? So macrophage activation syndrome is an overwhelming inflammatory reaction due to an uncontrolled immune response. So there is continuous activation and expansion of T lymphocytes and macrophages, and there is massive secretion of pro-inflammatory cytokines. So what these activated macrophages do, they engulf the hematopoietic elements in the lymphoreticular tissue. So those are the pathognomic features of macrophage activation syndrome.
So, can I have a highlighter, please? So, the central pathogenesis of macrophage activation is the defective cytotoxicity of CD8 and natural killer cells. So when these cells don't produce these cytotoxic granules, they don't engulf and they don't destroy the antigens in the way they have to do. So because of this defective mechanism, the CD8 cells, they get persistently engaged with the antigens and they produce interferon gamma, which activates the macrophage, and this macrophage in turn produces more cytokines to activate CD8 cells. So this occurs as a cascade. So with this cascade, lot of macrophages gets activated and lot of T lymphocytes get activated. So that results in the clinical manifestation. So the normal immune response is the normal cytolysis and destruction of the target cell. If that doesn't happen, there is uncontrolled expansion of cytotoxic T cells and uncontrolled activation of macrophages. So thus resulting in the clinical picture of HLH or macrophage activation syndrome. So why to recognize macrophage activation syndrome? It is one of the rheumatological emergencies. I hope you would have attended the talk yesterday on rheumatological emergencies. And timely diagnosis and prompt therapy is very essential for this condition. MAS can result in progressive multi-organ failure and eventually fatal outcome if unrecognized. And mortality occurs in around 8% of patients. So clinical features of macrophage activation syndrome, it overlaps with the hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis and remitting fever, purpura, mucosal bleed, lymphadenopathy, hepatosplenomegaly, liver dysfunction, CNS abnormalities, and laboratory abnormalities like fallen platelets, WBC, fallen ESR, high ferritin, high liver enzymes, elevated LDH, elevated triglycerides, fallen fibrinogen, elevated D-dimers, and prolonged PTAPTT, and bone marrow hemophagocytosis. So, in the context of pediatric rheumatology, macrophage activation syndrome is seen in three predominant conditions. Number one is systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Second one is systemic lupus erythematosus. And the third is Kawasaki disease. Rarely it can be seen in periodic fever syndromes and also rarely in juvenile dermatomyositis. So, this was the criteria which was initially followed. Because the pathogenesis was thought to be the same, so the criteria which is applied for the genetic forms of HLH has been applied to the macrophage activation syndrome in pediatric rheumatological conditions also. However, the last two, natural killer cell activity and increased serum soluble IL-2 receptor alpha, these are not measured in all routine labs. And coming on to these three features, platelets less than 1 lakh, neutrophils less than 1,000, and fibrinogen less than 1.5 grams per liter. If you pick up macrophage activation syndrome with these clinical features, then the patient is in a very advanced stage of macrophage activation syndrome, because systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis as a prototype has very high platelets and neutrophilic leukocytosis. So during the process of macrophage activation syndrome, they develop decreasing neutrophil counts and decreasing platelets, not to the tune of this much low. And also, hemophagocytosis in bone marrow, it is not always a required criteria. And serum ferritin more than 500, it can be seen even in the active flares of systemic JA. So, next came the preliminary criteria for macrophage activation syndrome. So this is proposed by Angelo Revelli in the year 2005 and it's published in the Journal of Pediatrics. So here, the laboratory criteria, we can see the platelet count has been revised to 2.62 lakhs. And the clinical criteria, the CNS system dysfunction, hemorrhages, and hepatomegaly. And histopathological criterion, it is the hemophagocytosis in the bone marrow aspirate. However, even in this criteria, if we see the decreased white blood cell count, that is less than 4,000, it happens in a very advanced stage of macrophage activation syndrome. If we pick up the patients in this stage, then the game is lost. And also the hyperfibrinogenemia. Hyperfibrinogenemia occurs in active stages of systemic GIA. When they go into macrophage activation syndrome, the fibrinogen level normalizes and then reduces. So it is the falling trend that we have to pick up and not the very low values. And also hepatomegaly. This can be seen even in the acute stages of systemic GIA, not essentially in macrophage activation syndrome alone. So this criteria was again criticized. So now let us move on to a case. So this is a 6-year-old boy with high-grade intermittent fever, Clostridium type for 3 weeks, associated with rash at the spikes of fever and swelling of both ankles. He had hepatosplenomegaly and arthritis of both the ankles, and there was no serous cavity effusions. So before referring to our hospital, this is how the child went through. During day one of his illness, in his hospital stay, he had neutrophilic leukocytosis, elevated platelets, high ESR and high CRP, and a ferritin of 612 and triglycerides of 120. So first 3 days, he had a Clostridium type of fever. Whereas from day 5, day 7, we can see the total counts have started falling down and the platelet counts have gradually started falling down and the ESR, it went gradually low. And CRP, there is a hike in CRP values. And ferritin levels also shooted up, 2,460 and 18,900. And triglycerides, 240, 340. And fibrinogen, which is 4.2, and it has dropped to 2.1. So the important thing to be noted here is the Clostridium pattern of fever, it has changed to a continuous pattern of fever from day 5 of hospital stay. Subsequently, he developed irritability, increase in spleen size, and from day 11, he had frank features of macrophage activation syndrome. 3,000, 90,000 platelets, ESR, very low ESR of 2, high CRP, a very high ferritin, very high triglycerides, and very low fibrinogen levels. And he went on to MODS, he was on inotropes, and he was bleeding from multiple sites when he was actually seen in our emergency. So what went wrong here? So when do the macrophage activation syndrome has to be picked up in this child? So this has to be picked up at day 5, not at day 11. If we blindly apply the criteria, we would diagnose or we would pick up macrophage activation syndrome only at day 11, not at this point of time. So we should look at the trend of the laboratory parameters and the pattern of fever. So these two parameters are very essential to pick up macrophage activation syndrome. And that is the reason the topic has been rightly chosen, whether the macrophage activation syndrome, do we have to chase the criteria or to see the clinical patterns. So this is the clinical pattern that we have to recognize. The change in the fever pattern and the drop in the counts, drop in ESR, rise in CRP, and hypertriglyceridemia, hyperfibrinogenemia, and hyperferritinemia. So retreating the same, the clinical parameters, the pattern of fever, sensorium, change in sensorium, but it is often late manifestation, enlargement in liver and spleen size, and the most important thing is the serial monitoring of laboratory parameters. Platelet counts, white cell counts, ESR, CRP, liver enzymes, serum lactate dehydrogenase levels, ferritin, triglyceride, and fibrinogen levels. So this was our unit data published 7 years back. So we had 6 patients that time, and MAS was the presenting feature of systemic GIA in 4 of the 6 patients. And for treatment, IV methylprednisolone was used in 4 of them. Oral prednisolone and IVIG was used in rest 2 of them. And one child got expired due to progressive macrophage activation syndrome.
So this is the latest classification criteria which we had for macrophage activation syndrome complicating the systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis. One should always remember that this is a classification criteria. This is not a diagnostic criteria. So this criteria has been derived from various experts in this field of macrophage activation syndrome, and they came out with a conclusion that ferritin more than 684 nanogram per ml plus any two of the following: platelet counts less than 1.81 lakhs, triglycerides more than 156, fibrinogen less than 360, and aspartate aminotransferase more than 48. So this is the latest criteria which we have for macrophage activation syndrome. This should be used as a rough guide, not as a sole criteria to diagnose macrophage activation syndrome. So how to differentiate macrophage activation syndrome from infections? So both macrophage activation and infections, they have features of DIC, that is disseminated intravascular coagulation, and multi-organ dysfunction. Some differences are, usually in macrophage activation syndrome, there occurs drastic fall in counts. However, drastic fall is usually not seen in septicemia. And usually ESR and CRP both rise together in infections, whereas the ESR decreases and CRP gets elevated in macrophage activation syndrome. And elevation in ferritin levels is usually more than 5,000 in macrophage activation syndrome. And mild elevation in ferritin is seen in sepsis, that is between 500 to 5,000. Having said that, clinically it is very difficult to differentiate macrophage activation syndrome and infection. Infection and macrophage activation syndrome can coexist in a patient. So in emergency practice, if we have a doubt whether the patient has macrophage activation syndrome or infection, when the child has falling counts, better treat both. So this is the child which we published 3 years back. This is a three-year-old boy with systemic JEA and macrophage activation syndrome at the onset. So he had neutrophilic leukocytosis and thrombocytosis before the hospital admission, and he went on to develop progressive drop in the counts. His bone marrow showed hemophagocytosis, ferritin of 44,638. We always suspect macrophage activation syndrome. So better laboratory indicator to discriminate macrophage activation syndrome from SLE was hyperferritinemia, according to this 2009 article from the Italian group. Sensitivity and specificity almost nearing nearly 100%. And these are the new promising biomarkers which are upcoming for macrophage activation syndrome. So soluble CD25, it is the actual measure of lymphocyte activation status. And soluble CD163, which is an actual measure of monocyte or macrophage activation status. So measuring these levels can give an idea how much actually there is a lymphocyte activation and macrophage activation. And IL-18, these levels are found to be elevated only in cases of systemic JEA-associated macrophage activation syndrome. So there are around 5% of systemic JEA patients can have macrophage activation syndrome at the disease onset. So a child presented to us with macrophage activation syndrome, it is very difficult to delineate whether it is due to infection, it is due to systemic JEA, it is due to malignancy, or it is due to genetic cause of HLH. So this value, IL-18 value, if it is significantly high, that points towards the macrophage activation syndrome is due to systemic JEA. And these are the nutshell of therapeutic approaches. I'm not going into the detail. Usually IV methylprednisolone is given, 30 mg per kg for 3 to 5 days, followed by oral prednisolone. Cyclosporin A in cases of refractory macrophage activation syndrome, we generally use 3 to 5 mg per kg per day. Intravenous immunoglobulin when we always have doubt of infection. Anakinra, which is not available in India. Tocilizumab have found to be useful in case reports. So this is the nutshell of pathogenesis and where the drugs are going to act. So corticosteroids, it suppresses the macrophages and the CD8 T cells activation. The newer drugs on the block are the anti-interferon gamma therapy, JAK inhibitors, and anti-IL-18 agents. So this is the case 3, the case of pseudothrombocytopenia, which I was mentioning to you. This is a 5-year-old boy with systemic JEA. His fever improved, but thrombocytopenia persisted. Bone marrow was repeated again, which was normal. Ferritin was just 412, and other macrophage activation syndrome parameters are normal. So platelet counts in heparin and citrate samples were revealed normal platelet counts. So this is nothing but thrombocytopenia and systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis due to EDT-induced pseudothrombocytopenia. So the take-home messages are: macrophage activation syndrome is a rheumatological emergency that must be promptly recognized and treated. Do not rely on bone marrow for the diagnosis of macrophage activation syndrome. Criteria are only a rough guide. Recognition of clinical and laboratory clues are the mainstay for diagnosis and management. Thank you.